gold does nothing to account for the advancement in technology. And this is why, you know, 1 ounce of gold bought you a very nice suit in 1913 when the Fed was created. And today, that 1 ounce of gold still buys you the same nice suit. But if you sold that gold ounce in 1913 and you put it into the stock market, because the stock market also adjusts for inflation, but it also adjusts for technology, because the inefficient companies leave and better companies come into the index. And that is why if you had invested that ounce of gold into the stock market 100 years ago, you can probably own multiple suit factories today instead of a single suit. When it comes to memberships, as silly as it sounds, there could be a blockchain use there because no one has to know what clubs you are a member of. And in fact, some of those clubs don't even need to know who you are. So you can have, and that's when the use case comes in. As long as I have a token that gives me access to the membership, I just have to show that I have it. And I can enter somewhere. They don't need to know who I am. They don't need to know my identity. And you know, if there is an age restriction, there could be a third party that makes sure I'm of age and I can, let's say, enter a club or whatever. But that's different. That's a law in that jurisdiction. And but the point is that membership token shouldn't be used as a speculative tool. You should be buying it for the purposes of a membership. Now, granted, there are memberships that are very valuable. There are certain things like, hey, we have the best club in the world, but in order to you know, for our members to be happy, only 1,000 people can be a member of this club. And then you have to get one of them to sell it to you because we can only have 1,000. So yes, there is probably some speculative nature there, but I guarantee you no one is buying this membership in or for the sole purpose of reselling it later. You're buying this membership because you want it. We have that with like season tickets to certain sporting events. Yeah. It's popular in the US where I know it's popular in like the Green Bay Packers football, where it's the only sports team in a town and everyone wants it because there's only so many seats at a stadium and only so many few people have, you know, a waiting list. Or here's a better example, Tony Robbins. Tony Robbins is a huge sought after person. Tony Robbins has about, I think it's about 20 people or so. Maybe, I'm just taking a guess. Tony Robbins goes, you can go to a contract for private consulting where you have a 1 hour phone call with Tony Robbins once a month. So you are allowed 12 hours of talk time with Tony Robbins, 1 hour a month, and I believe this costs about $1 million. You pay that, and you can talk to him for 1 hour once a month, so that comes out to about $85,000 per a 1 hour phone call. And there is a wait list to get on this list to have 1 hour a month for a year. There's a wait list. So yes, that is a member. Now, Tony Robbins doesn't have to know who you are. You should be able to buy this anonymously and have the ability to talk to Tony Robbins, and he doesn't need to know who you are. But I guarantee you, no one is buying this for speculation to then resell it. It just makes no sense, right? You're buying it for the privilege of being one of those members and using that service. So yes, I do see a little bit of a use case in the blockchain for that. But these use cases are very few in between.
Thank you so much. It's the first time I've seen such depth in covering this topic, and I really appreciate it. Just now, Tony, you were talking about money becoming a digital form of money, the digital gold. And obviously to be money, there are three criteria. We talk about medium of exchange, we talk about unit of account, and of course, the store of value. do you believe like Bitcoin as of today? There's so much debate on whether it does tick the boxes or not.
I think Bitcoin is an amazing store of value. It's not the it's a volatile store of value, but this volatility has been trending up over its lifetime. And what makes it the best store of value is the unconfiscatability property. What better property to your store of value is the fact that it's unconfiscatable? I can't think of one. I think that's the greatest one. So it is certainly a store of value for me. I would rather store my value in Bitcoin than anything else. Now, I think it's an amazing medium of exchange because it's censorship-resistant value transfer. No one can stop my transaction. Is this transaction always going to be fast? No. Is it always going to be cheap? No. Is it always going to be private and secure? I hope so in the future, but even if it's not, it doesn't matter. I can transfer it and no one can stop it. Sometimes it's more important to be able to send that message than whether that message had encryption on it. So there is value in sending a message that no one can interfere with. So those two properties, I think Bitcoin is better than anything we have. Now, the big question comes about Bitcoin being a unit of account. That's gonna take some time. You don't just magically create a unit of account. In fact, other than the US dollar, the world hasn't really had a global stable unit of account in 100 years. It's been pretty much the dollar. Since World War I, mostly since World War II, it's been the dollar. The euro has only been with us for about 20 years, and it's way more volatile than the dollar. And then you can talk about any other currency. Gold, gold is a decent unit of account, but no one uses it. It's not good for today's digital age. So it's not easy to dethrone the dollar. It has a 100-year history. No one can do it. Libra can't do it because of a regulatory problem. China was starting to do it, if you asked me this question 10 years ago, I would have said, you know, China is on its way to potentially dethrone the US dollar in the next 20 years. Now we're 10 years later, and I'm like, China has really gone backwards in its attempt to do it, because what you need, it's not the US military, it's not the fact that oil is priced in the dollars, it's not anything like that. What makes the US dollar a unit of account and what makes the US dollar the world reserve currency is the fact that the world trusts the US dollar more than any other government, more than any other currency. And it makes sense. The US government is the most transparent government in the world. You may not like the US government, but it's still the most transparent government when it comes to money. Maybe not when it comes to its military, maybe not when it comes to what they do otherwise. But as far as the laws, the financial laws, the regulations, how much money is being printed, how much QE it has, the US government has a global responsibility to keep the US dollar stable. No other country has that. This is why you see other currencies devalue against the US dollar continuously, because those governments have absolutely no responsibility to the rest of the world. The US government can't just say, you live here in the UK, correct?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay, wait a minute. So I have our fiat currency. Oh, I happen to have $1 billion Zimbabwe note somebody just gave me. But let's talk about this. People underestimate us. This is a, 20-pound note.
Yep.
And I just heard that these are being discontinued in replacement for the plastic version. Now, people don't understand what that means. What that means is that you have a certain window, maybe it's a year, maybe it's 5 years, who knows, probably a year or two, where you have to bring all of your 20 notes to the bank, and they give you different 20 notes, which means they are canceling the paper currency. And every single government, except the US government, has done this in the last 30 years with every single note. So what that means is only if, let's say, your grandfather happened to, have a suitcase full of notes that he left in his basement and passed away and didn't tell anyone, and you found it, If it's US dollar bills, they still have value. But if they're any other paper currency in the world, they are nothing. They have no value. Governments cancel currency because they don't have a global responsibility. The US cannot say, turn in your $100 bill and we give you a different $100 bill. The US releases a new $100 bill every 3 to 4 years, but the old ones still work because even they know that people all over the world have $100 notes and they will literally destabilize the world by doing that because people are protecting their value in US notes. They may devalue 2% a year, but they're still pretty valuable. Like, I know the stories. Your $100 bill bought you a lot 100 years ago.
Yeah.
That's true, but it still buys you a pretty nice meal today. In fact, if you're savvy, a $100 note will keep you fed for a week or two. They're not worthless. But the fact that they still have value is also important. And people underestimate how important that is to have this kind of confidence. And the fact that the world has this kind of confidence in the US dollar is what keeps it a unit of account in the world reserve currency. If the world starts to lose confidence in the US financial system, something else has to take over. Bitcoin is not ready for that kind of prime time yet, but maybe in 10 to 15 years.
That's fantastic. So you see Bitcoin the same way the US dollar is to fiat currencies all across the world, Bitcoin will be that for the cryptocurrency space.
Well, no, I think it will be for the world.
For the world.
It already is for the cryptocurrency space.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, like here's another example. I'll give you a choice. Let's say I offered to give you 100 Bitcoin, what is that today?
Well, that's
$80,000.
Yeah.
$800,000. So 100 Bitcoin, 800,000, almost a million, right? Let's say I offered, let's say I was Roger Ver rich and I offered to give you $1 million in Bitcoin, real Bitcoin, not his fake Bitcoin, right? Or I will give you $5 million today in any other crypto of your choice. But you cannot touch it for 10 years.
I knew you could ask
which
that.
Which one will you pick? A million in Bitcoin or 5 million in any token, any currency, Ethereum, Monero, Litecoin, you name it. The ones that are about to come out, you know, the ones that are going to launch later this year. Who knows, right? You pick one, I give you 5 million in that or 1 million in Bitcoin right now. You cannot touch it for 10 years. Which one are you going for?
BTC.
Exactly, right? So Bitcoin already is the store of value for the crypto ecosystem. Everyone will take BTC, you know, except the people that are selling their scam coins. They're the only ones that won't, right?
I saw that question coming. I knew you were going to ask me the 10-year question. It's a great question, and it makes a lot of sense. Were you happy?
So going to that. Let's do that with fiat currencies, right?
Yeah.
I give you $1 million in Bitcoin right now or $5 million in US dollars. I'm assuming you're not going to want any other currency, right? Or $5 million in gold, right? You can choose $1 million in Bitcoin, $3 million in gold, or $5 million in US dollars. You can't touch it for 5 years. Which one you're choosing?
I can't diversify, no. I can't.
You can't diversify. You got to pick one.
I would go for Bitcoin.
Go for the Bitcoin,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Now, let's move Bitcoin out of the way. You know, 3 million in gold, 5 million in US dollars, can't touch it for 10 years.
I would choose gold.
You choose gold.
Yeah.
Now, keep in mind that 40 years ago, 1 ounce of gold was $500, right? And in 1980, it was $800. Today, gold is $1,350. So in the last 40 years, gold has not doubled in price. $800 to $1,300. Gold is up like 30, 40%. And that was 40 years, right? I'm giving you 10 years. So think about that. Gold may not be up 40% in 10 years. It may be, it may not be. But those that have made this bet you know, 40 years ago, should have taken the dollars.
That's very interesting. I'm just afraid of a potential crisis and as a hedge.
Yeah. But that's a toss-up. That's a toss-up. But you go for the Bitcoin, right? So Bitcoin is already becoming your safe haven. And when it's a better and more common safe haven than the U.S. dollar, then the U.S. dollar is in trouble and Bitcoin is going to do very well.
That is such a good point. Thank you so much for the examples. Just one thing before we jump into the trading. Obviously, you're a professional trader. You're a guy with real experience. You mentioned Facebook a little bit earlier, and obviously, these days, Facebook lost some of their biggest partners, MasterCard, PayPal, and everyone's like, you're walking on one leg. How did you respond to this situation? Is it good for us to have ill will towards them, or you don't really care? Or?
I don't really care. It's so hard to explain Libra. So in a way, Libra is an attempt to have private money by a corporation. And I don't really necessarily mind having private money. My problem is every corporation having their own private money. And now we're back to the world of shitcoins and the world of barter and the world of wildcat banking after Andrew Jackson in the US eliminated the Second Federal Reserve Bank. And now every single bank started issuing their own money. And then the people on one side of the country didn't know which bills were counterfeit and which weren't, because every bank had their own different money. And that's why the Secret Service was invented, in order to stop counterfeit bills. And then it just goes on from there. So it's an attempt at private money. So if the corporations decide to work together and create private money, that could be a decent challenge to government money. Now, governments are not going to be happy about the corporations creating private money. I personally think that corporations could do a better job in maintaining the monetary system than the current government does. They disagree. My opinion is also pretty irrelevant here. But their attempt to create this private money made no sense. They are backing it by government money. They would comply with all the government regulation. And I don't know why they needed those partners. Maybe they needed their money, but I think Facebook can afford it. They have a lot of money. So they really need those partners. They just need those partners to accept their money in their services. Like, they want MasterCard to accept Libra coin, though I'm not sure why they even need MasterCard. Maybe they would like to use MasterCard's rails to move Libra around, which they probably don't need, because people don't realize that the biggest users of Facebook are in India. India has like 250 million users of Facebook. US only has like 300 million people. Not all of them are on Facebook. I think US is like maybe 100, 150 million or something like that. So India comes in one. I think US comes in two. China probably would be one if it wasn't banned there. But India comes in number one. So do you think people in India would rather use Libra and send it to each other over Facebook, since they all have Facebook anyway? It certainly will be a better store of value than the Indian rupee. They would love it, right? So Libra isn't being built to destabilize the US dollar. It could really help the developing world. Now, of course, the moment Facebook does this, Facebook will probably be banned in India. So I'm not sure they're doing their company any favor by doing that. But I don't understand why they needed these partners to begin with. Libra is not going to be decentralized the way Bitcoin is. It can have, you know, certain people and they all have to agree on something. It'll be like a proof of stake system, and they can always create more coins. They will be the Federal Reserve chairman of Libra, and they can have a committee, and they can put checks and balances that we need like a 70 or an 80% consensus between these trusted parties that are helping maintain the Libra coin. And then every year we have a review, and one of these partners could be voted off or something, you know, and somebody else could come in. So they could put checks and balances on the Libra token. They're going to have it backed by a bunch of government currencies, it'd be great if they added some gold, if they added Bitcoin into that basket. But having a basket of things doesn't help. It's like people are like, you need to diversify your crypto. And my answer is really, why? Bitcoin isn't gold. I don't want to diversify my Bitcoin. I'd rather have 100% Bitcoin than 80% Bitcoin, 20% shitcoin. That's not really diversification for me. That's just, you know, diluting its value. It's kind of like saying, I want to diversify the holdings of, you know, what Google does. So I'm going to go find a bunch of penny stocks and I'm going to diversify my Google holdings and put 20% into these penny stocks. Like, sure, you can get lucky, but that's not going to go very well. But so Libra has, Libra could help the world, but governments are so scared of it instead of wanting to work with it that it may or may not launch. But Libra is not really a competitor to Bitcoin. It's not unconfiscatable. It's not censorship resistant. Sure, it'll be a better payment rails. It could be a better PayPal, which is useful, but Bitcoin will get there. We have smart people working on it.
It's really funny because Nouriel was talking about how we need FinTech, but we don't give a rat's bottom, you know, about cryptocurrency Bitcoin. And he's saying we already have WeChat Pay, Alipay, and all those things. But what he doesn't get is it's domesticated to a specific country. I cannot use WeChat Pay from here, the UK, to China, while Bitcoin is a borderless global phenomenon.
I will take Bitcoin over everything else that's considered FinTech combined. Bitcoin is literally FinTech. That's what it is. It is financial technology. It's the revolution, it's the revolutionization of our monetary system with the latest technology. That's exactly what it is. To me, Bitcoin is pure FinTech.
Beautifully put. Last question for you, my friend. You just talked about portfolio diversification allocation. You're obviously a professional trader, and there are a lot of people doing tech TA out there on YouTube. It's become like a fashionable thing that do not have the credentials that you'd have and the experience, especially the track record. But for those who want to start trading, Tone, like, what are some of the do's and don'ts that you try to focus on? Simple things that people can take away and avoid, you know, doing something wrong or just following, you know, the sheep or people who are just copying each other on online.
Sure. Well, I think the biggest one, well, I'm a believer in technical analysis. Fundamental analysis has its place, but the average person can't do detailed fundamental analysis. You can do high-level fundamental analysis. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Amazon's not a scam. I'm pretty sure Netflix is not a scam. They've proven themselves. I'm pretty sure Bitcoin's not a scam. It's proven itself. I'm pretty sure Ethereum is a scam, so let me not invest in that. You can do some high-level stuff, but you can't, you know, you don't have a bunch of interns, you don't have a bunch of employees that can go and do research on how much money they made, what did the CEO eat for breakfast, you know, how often is he going to the doctors. You know, you can't do that kind of research. That's fundamental analysis. That's what a hedge fund will do, right? If you don't know, go watch the show Billions. You watch Billions?
Never. Go watch Billions. Sounds interesting. Yeah.
It'll show you what a hedge fund does. And because they do fundamental analysis. They go in big, but they know their companies. As a technical analyst, as a technical trader, those are great tools. You watch what the big boys do, and you try to piggyback on those trends. I think some of the biggest mistakes that new people make in crypto, and we've all made those mistakes, is literally following other traders. I do shows all the time where I tell on YouTube live my opinion of the market, where I think it's going, where I think the price is going. You can't trade on that advice. That's not what it's for. You have to learn. You have to make your own decisions. You can, look at what another trader is doing. You can consider his view on the market, but you have to learn not only his tools and the tools that he's using to make a decision. You need to have confidence in your own tools because your own technical analysis tools can tell you something different. And we have thousands of technical analysis tools out there. And even if you choose five of those tools, the amount of combinations are now infinite. So no two traders should ever come to the exactly the same conclusion because they're using different tools. You need to learn how to trade, with technical analysis and trust in your own system. And my goal is to educate people how to trade with technical analysis so that they don't have to listen to anyone else, including myself, to make those decisions. So that's the biggest thing. Other than that, I have three rules that I teach in my classes and everyone breaks them. I'm not gonna elaborate on them, and they have some exceptions, but I'll just give you the general overview. One, I never double down bad positions. If I'm in a trade and that trade is going against me, I do not make that trade bigger. I do not lower my average cost basis. That to me, that's an equivalent of, you play blackjack?
Yeah.
You do, right? So when do you double down? When you have a 10 or 11 and a dealer has a 6? Or when you have a 6 and the dealer is showing you an ace or a 10, right? You double down when you're winning, right? Doubling down when you're losing is just adding to your mistake. So I don't do that. So that's my rule number one. My rule number two, and again, there are slight exceptions. There are times where you could add to a losing position under certain exceptions that I discuss in detail in my workshops. Rule number two, when I enter a trade and I decide where I'm putting in a stop loss, at which point do I cut this bad trade and I admit I was wrong, I do not remove that stop loss. I do not say, I have a feeling I'm going to remove the stop loss this once. That usually leads to some horrible outcomes. That's my rule number two. And my rule number three is, when you're in a trade and that trade is profitable, profitable to the point when you are thinking about taking some profits. At that point, you don't necessarily have to take profits if you have a feeling, but you have to set that stop loss to break even. Watching my winning trades turn into losers was so demoralizing, it leads to breaking mistakes one and two.
Such valuable information. We actually had Trader Cobb on like yesterday, and he said almost exactly the same thing as you. He said, forget your emotions, stick to your strategy, and never change, because emotions really hurt us, right? FOMO and all these crazy things. What's your take on sloping lines? He didn't happen to like sloping lines because he said it was very subjective, the angle of the line. And
so I don't mind trend lines. I don't mind sloping lines. They're not that subjective. I have certain rules where I, for those that are familiar with candlesticks, as long as my line doesn't break the candle's body, I'm okay. It can touch the tip of the shadows. It can cut through the shadows. A single sloping line, I don't mind using, but when it comes to having two sloping lines, which is referred to as a wedge, I don't like that, because with two sloping lines, you have way too much discretion and you can make it fit whatever you like. So I'm okay with a single sloping line, but not two sloping lines in tandem. But that also means that a single sloping line and a horizontal line give you a triangle, which I love to trade, whether it's ascending or a descending triangle.
Fantastic input. So if people want to find more about you and want to take your courses or whatever, where's the best place to find you?
Sure. Everything is Tone Vays on the internet. Tone Vays YouTube channel, Tone Vays on Twitter, and tonevays.com. I don't know if I have any courses right now. I do have webinars that prior recorded webinars that are up for sale. But I will be teaching these courses again. I have my upcoming conference coming up in Las Vegas in February, and I will be teaching a trading workshop there. It's called Unconfiscatable.
Yes.
And it's a general Bitcoin conference, also has a poker game the day after the conference that people can register for. Registration should be open. It's going to happen in February. So that's one place the workshop will be. I have another conference called Understanding Bitcoin, understandingbtc.com, where Bitcoin developers come and show you and demonstrate how to use Bitcoin features. I felt that was a very important need in the ecosystem that we didn't have. That one takes place in Malta at the end of May. And I'm doing for the first time, and there'll be more of these probably every 6 months, it's called The Financial Summit. You can find it at thefinancialsummit.com. And it's a high-end event for hedge funds and traders and high net worth individuals at a one-week retreat in beach destinations around the world. And it will move around. And that's the high-end event. It's only open to about 30 people. So, and it's not cheap, but it looks like it has a lot of interest.
That I would love to join that. That sounds absolutely awesome. We'll put the links below for everyone to be able to follow that. And of course, definitely follow you, Unconfiscatable. I said it.
Yeah, good job, man.
Okay, guys, so don't forget to like, subscribe, comment. If you have any questions related to Tone, we'll try to get back to you in a reasonable time frame. And definitely tune in every Wednesday at 8 o'clock UK time. Thank you so much and see you next Wednesday.